This is Outbreak News This Week, brought to you by the Global Dispatch Incorporated. Outbreak News This Week is your source for all the news about worms and germs. And now, your host, microbiologist and editor of OutbreakNewsToday.com. Here's Robert Harriman.
Well, good day, Tampa Bay, and welcome to your source for all the news about worms and germs. This is Outbreak News This Week. And I also want to welcome people listening on Facebook Live today. I don't do this very often, so I hope it's coming through well. And hello to you. And got a special interview on the first half of the show. As you can see, this book right here is called The Perfect Predator, A Scientist's Race to Save Her Husband from a Deadly Superbug. And on today's show, I'm very excited to have the authors of this very, very interesting book. So joining me today is Stephanie Strathy and Thomas Patterson. Hi, guys. Welcome to the show.
Good morning, or good afternoon, whichever it may be.
It's good afternoon right here in sunny Tampa Bay.
Great. It's wonderful to be joining you.
Great. Well, before we dive into the book and this incredible, amazing story, can you each give some background about yourself?
Why don't you start, Tom?
All right. I'm a distinguished professor of psychiatry at the University of California, San Diego. I was trained as a sociobiologist. My interest now, my research is on HIV prevention among sex workers and MSM, primarily in Mexico. I like to go to the beach. It's a sunny day. All is well. What else can I tell you?
Now that's good. And Stephanie?
Well, I'm an infectious disease epidemiologist by training. I've spent most of my career focusing on HIV and viral hepatitis in marginalized populations. And now I am the co-director of a new center called the Center for Innovative Phage Applications and Therapeutics, or IPATH.
Interesting. Well, that is really important as we unravel this story. The fact that you're an infectious disease epidemiologist, that clearly helped, right? And how long have you guys been married?
Well, it's going to be about, what, is it 15 years yet, honey?
Yeah, it's getting close.
All right, get the right answer there, Tom.
Okay. Yeah. Yes, it is the right answer.
Okay, perfect. Let's go ahead and get to the story itself, which is absolutely amazing. And it's 2015, and the two of you are vacationing in Egypt. Tom, can you pick it up from there?
Sure. Yeah, well, it was one of those trips that was a part of my bucket that I was trying to empty. We had had a wonderful vacation there, visited a lot of different sites. It was actually our last night. We were right across from the Valley of the Kings on a boat on the Nile and having a beautiful meal on under the stars. All was well. I was feeling great. And then we went to bed, and I woke up an hour or two later, and I was violently ill, throwing up and feeling just awful. And I continued to get worse and worse, and Steph was saying, let me call a doctor. And I was like, no, thanks. I'd rather not. And then she finally, as I complained of back pain and radiating pain around my back, she insisted on calling a doctor. And at that point, I relented because I was just so miserable. And a doctor came to the boat, and he gave me fluids and antibiotic and said, you'll be right as rain in about an hour or two. No problem. And he was wrong. I just kept getting worse and worse. So she called him back to the boat, and they decided to take me to the local clinic. Unfortunately, there was no hospital there in Luxor. And entered a clinic, which, you know, they were doing the best they could. But at the same time, I was still just violently ill. And finally, they did a CT scan of my gut and discovered that it was a pseudocyst or a big cyst in my gut. I guess at that point I didn't actually realize that. I'm sorry.
That's okay. You were kind of out of it, dear.
Yes. Go ahead and pick it up, dear.
Well, at this point, Tom was diagnosed with pancreatitis, which is an inflammation of the pancreas, while we were in Luxor. And I didn't realize how serious that could be. But he started to hallucinate. He thought that there was, people coming in to kill him. And luckily, we had travel insurance. I got a medevac first to Germany, where they diagnosed, as Tom said, a giant abscess in his abdomen that was actually caused by a gallstone that had blocked his bile duct and caused this abscess to form. And the doctor showed us this flask of brown putrid fluid in it and said, look, if this abscess had just formed, this fluid would be clear, but it's obviously been there for quite some time, but that's not the worst of it. He says there's something growing inside of this abscess, and we have to culture it to find out what it is.
Okay, right. So how long was Tom under medical treatment in Egypt?
Well, just several days, like about 4 days, but it felt like the longest days of our lives.
Sure, sure. So you got him airlifted up to Germany, and medical care perhaps was a little bit better. And they tell you that it's a multi-drug-resistant Acinetobacter baumannii.
Right.
You have some microbiology background, but what were your thoughts?
Well, at first I didn't recognize it when the doctor said the name of the organism. And when he wrote it down, it just twigged. I thought, wow, I think I remember plating this on my Petri dishes back in my bacteriology days in the 1980s at the University of Toronto. And back then, we just had to wear a lab coat and gloves. It was considered to be a pretty wimpy bacteria. So how could this become such a scourge? In fact, a few months later, the World Health Organization listed Acinetobacter baumannii as number one bacterial pathogen on their list of the 12 worst superbugs that are a threat to human health.
Right. And it actually gained an interesting nickname.
Arachibacter, because so many veterans come back from the Middle East with this pathogen.
Yeah. Okay. All this time, you were in regular contact with Dr. Robert Schooley. Either of you, who is Dr. Robert Schooley?
Right. Well, Robert Schooley's nickname is Chip, because he's a chip off his old block. And he had come to our rescue once before. He's a colleague of ours at UC San Diego in the Department of Medicine, and he was then the chief of infectious diseases, so the best person you could have on speed dial. And we had picked up MRSA on a previous trip, being the intrepid travelers that we are, and he was the first person I thought to call when things went sideways.
I'm talking to Dr. Stephanie Strathy and Thomas Patterson, authors of The Perfect Predator, A Scientist's Race to Save Her Husband from a Deadly Superbug. So Tom was then stabilized enough, right, to be airlifted to UC San Diego. But things didn't get much better.
That's right. In fact, they got worse because when I arrived back at UC San Diego, I just assumed that because we were surrounded by some of the top infectious disease docs in the world, that they would know what to do. But in fact, when they repeated the culture, they said, this was a multi-drug-resistant pathogen that was partially sensitive to 3 antibiotics and resistant to 15. But now, even though it's only a couple weeks later, it's resistant to everything, even colistin.
Yeah, that's amazing. And just going back to Chip Schooley, it was interesting when I first started reading the book. I mean, it didn't take me very long. I said, man, this story sounds really, really familiar. And actually, almost 2 years to this day, I interviewed Dr. Schooley for a paper that he published concerning your particular case. So I thought
that's
very interesting stuff. So Tom was stabilized, didn't get much better. Now, you were, and Tom, you were incredibly lucky, as you know, that you have this loving wife who also had a good knowledge of infectious diseases, and she did mass amounts of personal research. And during this process, you couldn't find a treatment. You were looking for alternative antibiotics, and you eventually came across something called bacteriophages. Stephanie, can you talk about that?
Sure. Sure. Well, the doctors basically told me that there was nothing else that they could do. I realized that he was, you know, slipping away from us, you know, a little by little each day. And I had a conversation with him where I asked him to squeeze my hand if he wanted to live. And it was, you know, one of the most harrowing days that I could ever remember. And when he did squeeze my hand, I decided, okay, well, what am I going to do? I got to do something. Even though I'm not a medical doctor, I know how to do research. So I went home and I hit the internet and I used PubMed, which is our search engine that the National Library of Medicine has developed and made publicly available to anyone. And I put in the keywords for his superbug and alternative treatments, and up popped a paper that listed phage therapy or bacteriophage therapy. And that rang a bell because I remembered from my virology class, even though it was 30 years ago, that phages are viruses that have naturally evolved to attack bacteria. Chip refers to them as really living antibiotics. And so I thought, wow, maybe we could use phage therapy to cure Tom.
Yeah. Yeah. And can you explain to the audience, because there may be lay people listening, what is bacteriophage or phage therapy?
So the phage are actually the most ubiquitous organism on the planet. They're 100 times smaller than bacteria, but they're viruses that really are parasites of bacteria. And they're everywhere that you find bacteria. So they're in soil, they're in water, they're in our bodies, on our skin. And if you have bacteria that you're trying to kill that are, you know, found in your gut, the best place to find what the perfect predator that preys upon them is actually in sewage and barnyard waste and garbage dumps, some of the worst places you can imagine. So actually some of the phages that we sourced from various places were directly from these environmental sources. So I like to tell Tom he's fully you-know-what.
Yeah, there you go. And the interesting thing is this is not a treatment that's used in the United States. Some countries in, I think, Eastern Europe may still be working with that.
With
antibiotics, we kind of left it behind us. But the Navy was working a lot on this.
That's right. And first, you know, when I approached Chip and I said, hey, what do you think about phage therapy to cure Tom? And he said, wow, what an interesting and intriguing idea. If you can find phages that can match Tom's bacterial isolate, I'll contact the FDA and see if I can get a compassionate use permission. And, you know, then I had to find the phages. And that was even more daunting to me. But I went back to the internet, did a search for, you know, researchers that were studying phage that matched Tom's bacteria, so Acinetobacter baumannii and phage, and up popped a couple of names. I wrote them, and Ryo Young from Texas A&M responded and basically turned his lab into a command center where one of his graduate students actually lived at the lab, slept there and everything for a couple of weeks, and they found a cocktail, several phages that matched Tom's bacteria. So Chip did call the FDA expecting that he was going to have to explain to them all about what phage were, and they knew all about it. They were just looking for a case like this that would help them collect the data that they need to kind of move the field forward. And they also put us in touch with the Navy, which was great because they also found a phage cocktail, several phages to put together in a cocktail, and we received both right in the nick of time.
Yeah, and Tom, in your condition at this point, I mean, do you recognize any of this or...
Well, I'd say basically I was in a coma and yeah. I was hallucinating, and we wrote about interludes in our book.
So you were in really, really bad condition at this time. So you probably learned of all this after recovery. Yeah. So the treatment option was a success. And from the book, it says there's no adverse effects, but you know, before you started this, there's a lot of unknowns, is right, Stephanie?
Absolutely. We had really no idea how to administer phages. And Chip did a lot of homework. He talked to experts from Eastern Europe and also at the NIH who had some early research on phage therapy. And they advised that because he was fully colonized, that we better treat him intravenously.
Yeah. So Tom, essentially the stars just totally lined up for you, right? You got this scientifically astute wife who did a lot of research. You had Schooley, you had these other players from the Navy, you had your family, your children that came in to see you. Yeah.
This is all being at the right place at the right time. All of the, as you say, the stars lined up. My having a wife that I had chosen carefully prior to becoming ill, obviously, was pivotal in my success.
Of course. Yeah, yes, and I'm sure your kids are incredibly happy about it too. So, Tom, can you talk about the recovery and from the point you came out of the coma, more or less, when the bacteria was eliminated from your body, and can you progress it up to how you feel today?
Sure. Basically, what happened was initially 4 days after the infusion, the first time they infused it for a few days, I woke up from a coma. My daughter was there. I lifted my head off of the pillow and kissed her. And then things over the course of the next, I was in the hospital for a total of 9 months and had a number of setbacks due to other issues, including having other bacteria get into my blood and give me a septic shock. But in essence, I had lost 100 pounds, all of my muscle mass, had to learn to talk, how to swallow, how to talk, and walk again. It took it takes about five times as long to recover from a hospitalization like this as the length of time. So it takes about 4 years to recover from the 9 months that I was in the hospital, and I'm now 3 months out at this time. We've been to Costa Rica bird watching, and we've been to Africa. We've been back on the road. I'm feeling very good.
Good for you.
No side effects.
You jumped right back into your bucket list.
That's right.
Good. Stephanie, any final thoughts on the story or in the?
Yeah, well, I mean, I set out to save my husband, and we really had a global village of people who stood up. There was many of whom were total strangers that deserve most of the credit. But the real amazing thing that's happened is that we've now treated several other people intravenously with phage therapy as a result of Tom's case, not just here in San Diego, but across the U.S. and internationally. And as a result of this, we've now opened the first phage therapy center in North America called iPath. Chip and I co-direct this. And we are not just treating compassionate use cases like Tom's, but if anyone has a antibiotic-resistant pathogen that is no longer responding to recommended antibiotics, they may qualify for phage therapy on a case-by-case basis. But our major goal now is to move phage therapy into clinical trials. First, with some smaller translational studies that will inform larger efficacy studies, because if it can be shown that it is just as good or better than antibiotics, then it can be licensed alongside them. And one of the last pieces of really interesting information was that we found in Tom's case and in several others that there was actually synergy between the antibiotic and the phage, so that when they were co-administered, that they actually both did better than each would alone. And in fact, this resensitized the bacteria to one of the antibiotics. And so even if phage was to fail in clinical trials, I don't think it will, but we have to be dispassionate scientists about this. Even if it was to fail, if its sole purpose ends up to resurrect a failing antibiotic regimen that's been on the shelf because of multi-drug resistance, then that's still a game changer for the field.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Stephanie, do you have a link to your new bacteriophage organization?
Yes. So our website is ipath.ucsd.edu, and our email address is ipath@ucsd.edu. So if you have a superbug infection, or your physician or your family member or your patient, you can write us at iPath, and we will try to help you. We are a nonprofit. We are fundraising so that we can move this field forward and that phage therapy isn't forgotten for another 100 years. And let's not forget that, you know, by the year 2050, one person every 3 seconds is going to be dying from a superbug infection. Yeah. Tom's case is like, he's like the poster child for this post-antibiotic era that we're staring in the face.
Yeah.
Most people don't realize that, you know, that multi-drug resistance is a bigger threat to human health than climate change in our lifetimes.
Yeah, no, I concur. You're preaching to the choir on that one. Again, the book is The Perfect Predator, A Scientist's Race to Save Her Husband from a Deadly Superbug. And I want to thank you, Dr. Stephanie Strathy, Dr. Thomas Patterson. Thanks for joining me today to talk about the book / your story. I appreciate it very much.
Thanks. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks for having us.
All right. You take care.